Hello, everyone. Thank y'all for staying. I am Addae, the Associate Artistic Director here. And first, let's give the actors a round of applause. I adore this piece. I adore their performances. And most of them are gone now. But I have some amazing guests up here with me today. I'm going to have them introduce themselves and talk about the organizations they're from and the work that they're doing in relation to the themes of the play. So, start with you, Margaret.
All right, I'm Margaret, Baldwin, Pendergrass. I teach at Kennesaw State University in theater and performance studies. And my main experience working with people in reentry and returning citizens is I co-coordinate and teach a course. It's called the Clementi Course in the Humanities, along with my partner in crime, maybe not that word, Dr. Tanja Link, and we are part of Common Good Atlanta, that is an educational resource for people who have are either currently or formerly incarcerated, bringing higher education to people in prison. And we specifically focus on the class for people in transitional centers. So we work with individuals in three different transitional centers in the Georgia Department of Corrections, and then also people who are back in the community. So we call it the Common Good Community Class for returning citizens. So that's the main thing.
What she said. So we're talking about the other project. Yeah. All right. So in addition, I'm Tanja Link. In addition to the adult population that we work with, we also run a course, a applied theater course, at Kennesaw with students that are currently residing in different juvenile detention or development centers around Georgia. And what we think, and I'm in sociology and criminal justice, and I run the internships there, so my main mission always was to bring the students who will devote their lives to working in the in criminal justice, one for one another, to actually meet the people that they're going to help and they're supposed to help and supposed to protect and work with. And so with Margaret together, we bring Kennesaw students together to learn alongside as peers with the students in the BJJ, and we're planning on doing the same thing with the adult populations. So our students can learn from our students at the BJJ.
Hi everyone, my name is Ladji Ruffin. I am an owner of Authentic Braille Masters LLC, where I own a Braille company where we produce books for the blind. I also work for Georgia Department of Behavioral Health and Development and Disabilities. I run a forensic peer mentor program where we hire individuals that have just as lived experience and allow them to go back into the prison system, jails, the criminal justice system, court systems, to offer peer support to individuals that either have mental health challenges or substance use disorder. I'm also just as impacted as well. I spent 23 years inside the Department of Corrections. I've been out going on 8 years now. I'm also a graduate of the program at Morehouse School of Medicine, and I currently attend Mercy University. Go Bears. And I'm also a student of Common Good, which I'm in my last class. That's pretty much it. And I'm also a grandfather, father, husband. Done the things that I'm most proud of, regardless of all the accolades I get. I just love that my daughter can call me father, my son can call me father, my four grandkids can call me grandfather. That's the one, that's the title that I love the most. Thank you.
Hello everyone, my name is
Dominique
Jones. I am the membership organizer for Bueno. I am also the Pulitzer Prize Tour. Women on the Rise, what we do is provide our front services for those for our ladies that are going out of prisons and jails. We help them better reintegrate back into society. We help with crucial documents, also help them with jobs and shelter. Can't have a marijuana in life, you don't have a place to stay, you don't know where you're going to stay. sleep at night. What qualifies me to do this is I do 20 years of prison here in Georgia. March the 9th, I was out 4 years. I've been out 4 years. I just love what I do. I love what I do. I love to help my fellow people that are coming out. When I was in prison, I taught reentry, and I learned once I got out that everything that I talked to the people, the script that they told me to read and regurgitate every week, it isn't true. A lot of the resources aren't available anymore. So my task when I first got out was telling everybody, hey, this is what you really need to do once you get out. And one of the guys came to me and they said, hey, why don't you help do this with us? Join the team. And so now I've been doing it for 2 years, July 11th, and I love what I do. And I'm a certified peer specialist, I'm a forensic mentor. I go back into the jails, ACDC, which is Atlanta Detention Center. I go in there and I make transition plans for the ladies and I follow them on permanent release. I helped them for a whole year, and even after the year with Fulton County and Grady, they still come over with me and women on the lines, and I still want to continue this. So.
Right. Hello, everyone. My name is Dominique Harris. I'm also just in fact, did 12 years, been on the floor. But I wear a lot of hats like everyone here. My mentor, on the inside. It's crazy. How many times we've been together. So I mentor at Ridge at Promise Youth now. I'm an accountability partner for guys coming out, basically returning citizens. I'm creative. I've made film. I have MS. I'm not as great as Lydia right now, but I am compliant. but just trying to get myself grounded in the space and really turn my pain into purpose. Because we gotta work, so why not do something that you want to do? And myself in this space has been very gratifying, and I'm not really trying to find gratification in my work. It's just been important. And lastly, I work with Jordan Jess Project right now. I'm the outreach coordinator, so that's very empowering because I'm responsible for helping people incarcerated individuals understand their vulnerable rights, their expulsion and restrictions, right?
I am a co-founder and the CEO of the Reentry Arts Connection. That's my co-partner right there, Gary Yates. Give a round of applause. A little bit about my background. While I was studying on the graduate level, theology on the graduate level, I did a project about pulling together resources on behalf of individuals coming out of incarceration. I did the paper, got the aid. I forgot about it, but that wasn't the end of it, so it kept following me around. So I eventually co-founded an organization that's called the Big Country Reentry Coalition, which operates out of Abilene, Texas. And its existence is to make sure that people who are re-entering in that area are aware of the resources, the real resources that are available to them. And so I'm excited about the work that continues, even as I move back to Atlanta. Right now, again, I'm with the Reentry Arts Connection, and we're relatively new. But our goal is to connect people who are impacted by the justice system with the power of the arts. And so tonight is like a sweet spot for our organization to see a play about individuals who experienced the incarceration situation and who are now in their own reentry process. And so our organization is a big collaborator. Right now what we do is we look for organizations that are already working with individuals who are experiencing that. And we partner with them to offer them free workshops in things that are related to the arts. Right now, our focus is on the film industry, and so we've done a number of workshops related to digital storytelling, also animation. And we're excited that we have a workshop coming up with Women on the Rise, which is about empowering the individuals to tell their story. And so that's our excitement being here, just being able to take two power sources, individuals who have lived experience and the arts, and put them together and see the magic that will happen.
Yeah. There's two questions for everybody here, and I'm gonna open it up for y'all. The big question is, and I've been thinking about this a lot, is language. What language should we be using when it comes to dealing with folks who have been previously incarcerated. What language should we use, and what language should we get, you know, stop using?
Well, it's so funny, I have language cards in my purse.
But I will take out one. Basically, what we always say for people, and identify us as people, as who we are. So instead of saying felon or incarcerated, I mean, just different dehumanizing words like that, a person that has been incarcerated, or and just identifying the person first, always person, and then the next after that. It's the same thing with mental health, a person that's diagnosed with. So try to take that stigma as she's a felon, she's a criminal. No, this is a person that has a crime, or a person who is formerly incarcerated, or just go like that. But we can pass it on, and then I'll pass on some.
Which one?
Yeah, it's
kind of
weird.
Anybody else that thinks about the language?
I'm not touching that too long. But like she said, keep the people saying
that. Can you speak up a bit?
I learned some very important when I was in class. Just reading things. You have to make people more important than things. And that's very wrong. A felony is a thing. You know, don't label me as a felon. I did something, but that's not me. You have people that do things all the time, so let's not convince people to label. People are way more important than things. So my biggest thing on being incarcerated is you have all the people there that you would say are the worst people in America. But sometimes we get along. Some kind of way there's respect, because the human, I think it was something in the play that really hit me. Freedom is a great equalizer. Mm-hmm. Everyone's evil. You might have been the scum of the earth. It's, you know, all those crimes we don't like to mention, but in here you come on this other side and you're not evil anymore. So everything is humanized. Just humanizing a bit, because people can cope with things. We don't know what they go through. A lot of mental health situations, a lot of lack of education, everything. I was incarcerated at 17. I don't think I can say 17. I'm 34 years old. So we have to humanize people and use their language.
It says, instead of inmate, felon, convict, criminal, handicapped or disabled, drug abuse, drug addict, junkie, illegal alien, or crazy or psycho, use this. Incarcerated person instead of inmate. Formerly incarcerated person instead of felon. Justice impacted person instead of convict. Persons living with a disability instead of handicapped or disabled. Persons with a substance abuse disorder instead of drug abuse. Undocumented person instead of illegal or illegal alien. And person living with a mental health condition instead of crazy or psycho. And this is on our site with Women on the Rise. And when we go out, as I show you, I have my first all these festivals out. And just different things to teach people, even when I speak with lawmakers and judges and DAs, first thing I say is, hey, can we kind of change the language around what we're doing? While you're working with me, you know, respect me as a person, I respect you as a person, as judge or DA or officer. So just making sure that I own the room when I come into the room. Making sure that my presence is felt and they know that, you know, that's dehumanizing. You put me in there to dehumanize me. You so-called wanted me to come out and be rehabilitated, but, you know, it's all about what I respect for myself and the space that I need and the area that's broken. So.
I may not be perfect at it, but all of the references that you heard me say, they're from listening. They're from being in a relationship with individuals with lived experience and allowing them to educate how do I walk through this space. And so that's my thing, is more than listening ears.
Right. Thank y'all for that. Because I do think language is crucial in how we refer to each other in general, but especially considering these circumstances. I would love to know, from each of you, what in the play resonated for you personally and for the work that you do.
Well,
that's
not
doctor.
So I had a chance to hear readings of the play, and so I kind of came in with the But a big part of it is how an individual demands respect and dignity for themselves. So CLYDE would push you way beyond the limit if you let her. And there's a certain amount of that in that space because people aren't really accustomed to her yet. But eventually, as individuals start to own themselves and who they are and their role in making their environment what it needs to be, that there's certain things that you won't tolerate. And so I think that that's what this place speaks to me is, at some point, regardless of what has happened in the past, you got to find your space to demand the dignity.
I wrote a lot of notes. So, but I can summarize it, because it stood out. Conforming versus entitlement. They found, even though they was conforming, they didn't have any choice, they couldn't get out, they had jobs, but they found entitlement, selfishness. They found purpose. And I'm someone, but I can tell y'all time, I ain't going to do this. I'm going to do what I want to do. Because it feels like you are so restricted once you get the F on your report card. Everything, you have to do this. You have to break your bag. You have to do this. You have to do that. Now, I'm going to do what I want to do. Because I tell everyone, my mind didn't change as much. I just became aware of my decision making, if that makes sense. I really became aware of my decision making. And since I became aware of my decision making, I said, well, I know I'm going to be in the same place that made me make that bad decision. So I got to really figure out what I want to do. So conformity versus autonomy is very big to me because you can make $100,000 a year in hate. So I didn't want to be in those situations because I'm a very motivated person and I know I could have went to eating there and I had all these plans, but I didn't necessarily know if I was going to be happy. So just conformity versus autonomy, because those sounds making and finding love and sounds making, those things really got like, okay, I'm in a situation, but my mind's not locked up. That was my reason.
For me, it was their thoughts. When they said, I wake up every morning with my chest up, that just recognizing that, or them saying on the stage, well, we're not gonna be able to work anywhere else. I see women come out of jail every day and they say that. I'm like, hey, you love me. We'll pay for you to go to school. And just letting them know, when people hear me say that, I did 20 years. Can I do the things that you're doing now? Yes, you can. Follow me, I got you. So just hearing them say that it felt like they were in a jar and they couldn't get out, that I had that feeling. I've heard that feeling from someone and I hear it every day.
I think what really resonated with me when the guy said that he was living in a tent. We living in some very scary times, not only that you don't have a felony, of course, we've seen a lot of people losing their homes and consolidating, but just add the compound of that you have a felony, right? And you got to make three times the rent. And you know, I remember reading an article about Atlanta saying it's becoming the most place where you can't afford. It's becoming very unaffordable. And I'm seeing too many men and women that are coming out and they already was behind the eight ball off the grill. But you know, now you got these supportive houses that spring up. I'm not a big fan of supportive housing because they're charging too much and there's no exit plan, right? You could say, well, yeah, we allow this person to come and they're paying $900 and they staying in extended stays and they're paying more than my mortgage, right? And they just staying in a one room extended stay, right? And just have to just kind of just understand that dynamics is kind of like, what can we do about this? And that's why when I go to supportive housing, I always tell them, well, what is the exit plan, right? You know, they can't stay in here and stuck within this cycle because that's what I'm just seeing. It's kind of like it's the same cycle and we try to pat out on the back that, hey, we got them a job, or we got her a job, and we got them in the supportive housing, but they're stuck in there. They're calling us 6 months, a year later, hey, I'm living in a standard state now. I'm living couch surfing with people. So that kind of really resonated with me to really think about that. And I hope, you know, as a community, that y'all think about that as well, because that's not right. And if we want to continue to help our individuals, we got to go to these landlords, we got to go to these individuals that are renting these particular properties and just really get into them and say, hey, if you want to stay in our community, you're going to have to support individuals like this. And we're going to have to try to, and I close with this, we're going to have to make them take the class. We're going to have to, I feel like I should not, if I have a felony, that I should be able to live wherever I want to live. Too many of our men and women, they making the money, but they can't rent nowhere. I had one person that had a felony 30 years ago, and he said, oh man, I can't rent nowhere. Man, I make triple times, you know, the pay, I can pay straight out. This right here to me is just a crime. Mm-hmm. And I just close that. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
The parts that resonated most with me in relation to the work that we do, and I'm gonna just carve out the work that I do in criminal justice as the internship in my department, is really that you have to afford my students in that point the chance to meet the person rather than just read about numbers in a book. And until they meet a person who's affected and who is impacted by the justice system, and they see that they are just a rich daddy bailing them out away from being on the other side, or they were just lucky, or they just, you know, they could buy their drugs behind the gates, not have to be out on the street. That their privilege is really what separates them. And to create, just to meet people where they are and to have the story, not just the bad side, but have the story that there's a whole person and not just the crime. That really resonated, that's really what we're trying to accomplish with having our students meet and not mentor, but be equal to other students in the class. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and I can say that I read in a student reflection yesterday, one of the criminal justice majors that said, you know, when Marlon, who teaches with us, said that the only difference between one of the girls we were working with and us is that we didn't get caught. And the student said, I didn't believe it when he said that. But when we went to Macon, we were doing the work, I saw what he meant. And that, I think, is something that you can say that as much as you want, but if somebody can get that experience on their own, it does change things. And we just had a graduation for a group at Common Good Atlanta that's gone through a year of classes at Atlanta Transitional Center, and they all gave speeches. And it's so moving to me because it is a chance, I think, for people to recognize their voices and to celebrate their voices. And what I feel when I'm doing the work is that it's not like that we need the wisdom, we need the complexity, we need to understand how our neighbors are all right here, and that we're all connected. And that may sound sort of high in the sky, but when you're in the classroom together, it's there. And that what resonated in this most, I think, is that idea of it wasn't even so much something that they said, but you saw the community building, and you saw the support, and that I think is what we all need to be.
Any questions for these wonderful, brilliant people?
How do you do it? You guys mentioned the KSU program where you work with juveniles and you introduce them like to the arts and stuff. What would you say the impact of, I guess, introducing a young person, a young troubled person to like the arts? Yes.
I think it's a crime that they don't already have that access. And that for a lot of what I've experienced from doing this for 4 years is that there's incredible gifts, there's incredible talent, there's incredible wisdom in these young people, and all they need is a container to share it, and it transforms them, but it transforms all of us.
They're doing Shakespeare right now, and you can imagine how they did not want to do Shakespeare, and they have been producing some of the most beautiful work.
We're doing a sort of sonnet mashups, working with Shakespeare and then contemporary poets who are also using the sonnet form, and they're writing incredible work. I just think it's stupid. It's stupid not to have the arts. And
I think what is really amazing is to see them find their voice, because they've never been listened to. Their voice was not important. And they don't have agency. Everything is determined for them. And so to tell their story, or to tell a story, it doesn't have to be their story, to find the words and put themselves out there and get positive feedback. That's, like, to me, that's really helpful. To observe.
I mean, you all know that. Right? I don't know. What do you think?
I don't think. So I've been through academia and I always like arts better. I like to write, but I don't like creative writing. I don't like academic writing, because I like all of my writing. My writing is creative. So I call the arts like the in-between academics. Because where you're doing an academic essay, or you're articulating, you're contemplating, you're doing these theses, and coming up with all these ideas to present to a professor. Well, people from my background are not like that. That's just real. That's part of the problem with me. I didn't get educated into making it my life. But art reflects culture. And I can always, it don't matter what age they are, they can write, they can draw, they can help you come up with something that recognizes their voice. So the arts are necessary, especially for those that are, I don't want to say it like that, but don't have the academic education. Because that film can still get out there. They might just can't say it, they might just can't express it. But let me draw a copy of it. Help me make this video. Help me make this TikTok. Help me make this real. All that is part in the person finding themselves and how to express themselves, because these young kids, and not even just young people, I think it's all of us, it's an expression. I just don't know how to express ourselves. And if you don't know how to express yourself, you probably don't need it. So that's, I think the arts are very important. It's been essential to me, because I don't like to write essays all the time. Sometimes I just want to get my phone and start recording something. And I can still get my message out.
And I think it would be a problem. A lot of times, growing up in the neighborhoods that I grew up in, Edgewood, Atlanta, and in part, not having an outlet. When I got to prison, I was in theology, I'm a Mercer, and I would write, they told me one time to write a song, so I wrote my laments. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I would just go in there, once I start typing, it would come out. But it was what I went through my life. So having an outlet, a positive outlet, and then bringing people into that side and letting them know this is what's happening, this is what I went through, this is what I witnessed, this is what I saw, this is what trauma brought out of me. So,
I'm sorry. Just real quick, and sort of a side note to that, as we're talking about people who have been involved or been impacted by the criminal justice system, is that the arts have the power to reduce recidivism. Any number of studies out there that organizations that have been doing it for a long time, and they see the recidivism rate go way down. So people are less likely to go back to incarceration, depending on their experience with the arts, among other things.
I was just going to add that sandwich making was the art.
Exactly. Yeah.
And it seemed as though what the trigger that helped the ending be created is that it was the integrity of the sandwich that made them realize the integrity of themselves. So, I'm really confused by the ending where the woman turns suddenly. My daughter said she saw bars come down. I've missed that house.
Mm-hmm.
But maybe there's something about how she's still in prison.
Yeah, she's trapped in
a
lot.
She does not have any favor.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
All right. my name is Rob Davis, and I'm the outreach peer specialist and working on my designation for National Recovery Coach for Recovery Community Incorporated and Recovery Resources in Atlanta Midtown. And it's interesting, more of a comment, all of the things that you all are speaking of when it comes to arts. I'm very involved in the arts, been through my family. And one of the things, art, that we're even connecting with Dr. Curtis and Gary through the Reentry Arts is using arts as a pathway to recovery. You know, and even dealing with incarceration, individuals, you know, coming out of prison. Everyone is in recovery. Take all those off the table. Life. A lot of us are in recovery from life. And a lot of times what traps us or what hinders us is the ability and the opportunity to have a pathway. A pathway to get through and get out. And to be able to find ourselves, get back to ourselves, so that we're not stigmatized by the definition and the labels that people put on us, you know. And with the play, I was so enamored. Every bit of me was touched. I was a sandwich maker, you know, pride in sandwich makers. I mean, I owned, did a restaurant. I was incarcerated. I did drugs. So I was able to relate to every aspect of this play. And the fact that a lot of individuals go through these things, whether it's substance use disorder, whether it's incarceration, is because a lot of times we're different. We have other ideas. And a lot of those ideas are constricted, and they're prohibited from allowing us to be able to do what we need to do to produce. So I think the arts is very effective, and instrumental in being able to help people get over and get through, and to become stabilized. Like you said, you don't want a person to go through the program, 6 months later, now they're back. So it's about how do we stabilize these individuals, and how do we get them to the point where their life, they can be paid for their pain, and they can produce something from the life and the mistakes that they've made, and not be defined by it, but be driven by it.
I think we have time for one more question. Yes.
Oh, first, thank you. Thank you for the wisdom shared, and thank you for the wisdom and the humor and touching in the play. It's beautiful. I just had a question, and this is to everyone, but also you were saying that there was a difference. One of the gifts that you were able to give was telling the truth. The difference between, it seemed like there was a party line as people were coming out and saying this, and then there was what the truth was. Can you share a little bit about what that truth was, you know, what the party line was, what the truth was, and finally, if anyone can share, if there are initiatives that are going on that we need to get behind legislatively or community-wise nationally, that there's a lot of stuff that's going on now, but if there's, you know, like one single thing that you want to say, go this, our mission statement, giving us our mission. But what was the, as I said, there, so that's twofold. What was the difference in the truth? And
so Women on the Rise, we just produced a book called What to Expect. And we put it in all the prisons. We sent it out to all the prisons. And I started with this book. My friend, Rob Hassan, Simpson Bay, she is our executive director. And I got out on the 9th of March, 2020, right before the pandemic. She got out on the 24th. And once she got out, she called me. I said, girl, nothing that they said is true. Nothing that they said is true. You can't use this ID to go everywhere and get anything that you need. You don't get food stamps automatically the first day you get out. You can't go and get housing and go down to the human resource office and go, they give you a list of things and this is what you should do. upon release, and this is from Reentry probably in 84. Mm-hmm. Okay, so I came in 2000, 18 years old, 17, turned 18, I got out, 38, going on 39, and I'm like, and they had me to teach this reentry because Jones is what they call me, M.A. Jones. She has been in so long, she won't steal any of the crayons or any of the paperwork. She's going to do exactly what we tell her to read in this manual and read to people. People were coming back and forth, and I'm like, I didn't see that outside. But so many people will come back in and not even care to share what was going on out there. And I said, no, this can't be. You know, people are thinking, as soon as I get out, I'm going to give me a car. But they don't know when they go to the car dealership, you have to have insurance and license. So that was one of the things. Oh, yeah, I'm going to get a credit card. They don't know that sometimes your mama had already put lights in your name from 2012. You've been in for 20 years. That's what happened to me. So just letting people know that these are the myths and these are the facts, you know. And I started doing that. People started calling me as soon as they came out. Hey, what should I do, you know? Even though I had did so much time, I was still, and I would guess because of the education, theology, different colleges, like university, they'd come to the prison, and I was always involved in something that kind of kept my brain on the outside. But I was better at navigating, mm-hmm. even after doing 20 years. And I would tell people, hey, call me as soon as you get out, and I'll show you how to get a car. I'll show you, you know, what you need to do with your food stamps, and especially during the pandemic. Now things have changed. Reentry is different from even when I got out in 2020 to right now because post-pandemic. So then in my book with What to Expect, we had to write post-pandemic. This is what's going on right now. People are like, oh yeah, I'm gonna go get a house. Someone call me today. I think I should just go and buy the house and say, interest rates are so high. You're gonna be paying more than what you're paying for rent. I have a group that we have in the first of the month, and I let them know, like, this is what's going on. I just moved them to my new house. Guess what? I have to make 3 times the rent. Who's making 3 times the rent? So just with wages, what's going on now, just educating them. We also will be doing educational joint legislation. Let them know these are bills and these are things that are happening. This is what's ruling our life right now. Let's get involved. Let's make sure that we go down here, we go to the ropes on Capitol Day, we go to the ropes when it's time, and we go out there and we let these people know, hey, this is the face of incarceration, this is who I am, I want my rights back. I need my rights back, it's imperative that I have. Putting a face to incarceration, because they're passing bills every day on paper, but they're not looking at that person's face. One of the worst representatives that have pushed so much, he even pushed a 30-year life, his name is Robinson. He saw me at the lines, Robinson. Last name Robinson. He saw me at the lines, hey, you need to talk to me? Yeah, I do need to talk to you. I'm formerly incarcerated. What you look like? I need you to take some of those bills that are about to come down the pipeline. I need you to agree with, oh yeah, come on down to my office and talk to me. Put in the face, because it's hard for someone to say no when they're looking at your face. So just things like that, teaching my girls, giving them just talking points to go out there and feel confident. Some of them, you know, we can go into the Capitol. We have police that can go, we can't go in there. Yes, you can, that's your house. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's your house, we're going up in there. So just things like that, you know.
Has that book that they gave you to read verbatim been pulled? Is that no longer in the system?
No, I'm on parole. I can show you a picture in my phone. I went to my parole office that I just moved to Clay County where I was convicted. And I looked on the wall. They have the same disciplines convicted fellas on the wall. I took a picture and sent it to my boss. I said, can you believe this? It's here. They still got it on parole. I want you to take it down. But, you know, I'm talking with them right now trying to see if I can get the information. For them, this is, we have to have this on policy. It's not correct. Sir, it's not correct. I'm out here living this every day. You know, it's not correct.
So. Things don't change quickly in that presence.
I have one thing, quick thing from the educational side is what we see is a campaign to ban the box. Which means, so if someone has been convicted of a felony, they have to check that on a box of any application that they submit to a Georgia State University. And even though there has been a lot of push against that, I think that's one thing that we see there's a lot of people that want to go on and continue with a university, but I would say, you can speak to this, is that you are an exception in terms of being able to do that as seamlessly as you do. Do you want to speak to that, or what would you say about that?
When I always share my life, I always try to tell people, I fall in a very small category. I'm talking about very small, maybe about 50%. And of course, I understand that they try to use my image to say, hey, this is how it is. But really, it's not, And the thing about it is, just like within a play, the sense of community. So when everybody always asks me, how did I overcome, I had a sense of community, individual that was just like me, and we supported each other, and that what drove us, and that what makes lived experience, that what makes individuals that looks like you and been through what you've been through, and that's what helped, and that's what helped them in the name. And and I would say that, as a community, you're just having a conversation with your next door neighbor. Having a conversation with the person in the grocery store. The person that your patron that you're going to, hey, do y'all hire people that's previously incarcerated? It's just that simple, just having conversations. At times, I know that, we want to get on the street and get the bullhorn, but you have people that travel in different lanes. And really, the lane to be traveled is just having that conversation with your next door. Having a conversation with your husband on the way, you'd be surprised. That their views kind of change, and then that kind of ricocheted, and that's how we was able to fight for education, because now you have professors and it holds a lot when they say this is a professor, and it holds a lot with the individual when they come in and we're from this particular prestigious university. That gives a lot of. Somebody that's behind the walls, they'd be like, and that gives them the confidence what they need to be able to make that push. So when they have that check on the box that they can push past it, and they can get the letters of recommendation, because that helps a lot. I'm trying to tell you that having something that have a letterhead on it that's going to somebody, they kind of pay attention a little bit more to letterhead versus this and that. So that's another thing that I always encourage our young men and women to do, to make friendships with academia, because they can get you in spaces just like they got us in this space, right?
I have a question about the agreement. Is that only Georgia, or is that national, or is that going national, or what is that?
Right now, we're only Georgia, but we have a lot of national coalitions. Everybody that coming in with this.
Okay.
And we don't have to. So yeah, that's basically. There are other ones that
so
are.
It's taking a while to just get things going.
So we were collating a lot of different places like Detroit, Nevada, California.
Thank y'all so much. Oh yeah, go ahead.
Thank you, Joseph. So it's really, I think, information. So something simple as voting, right? I work with Georgia Justice, so I didn't know this stuff. It's 450,000 formerly incarcerated individuals in Georgia. Donald Trump, I only want to say that because I don't care, but in 2016, he was claimed by 10,000 votes over 4 states. In this one state, it's 450,000 that vote that has a felony. And how many people with a felony think they can vote? And I didn't even vote, I don't vote right. So me thinking about that, like, that's the power. So that's the community's job, just like Elijah said, have those conversations. Because you go to someone, they think they can vote. I don't think I can rent, so why would I think I can vote? Like, that's automatically, you don't think you can do that. That's a big drop of people. And I ain't just the president, go vote for your head, go vote for the chair. Like, talk the language that they want to hear you talk. Like, no, boy, they're not going to vote for president. So we got to wrap because that is a big number, 450,000 and another 175,000 on probation. That eligible for 3 years, that's power. We got to recognize that as power. Those are our people.
This is democracy. I pay taxes.
Can the people vote that are incarcerated out of the Memorial Drive jail?
The jail, where if you don't
have. They all vote out there, or none of them vote?
If you're not convicted. So if you're sitting there and you're waiting on your time, or waiting on the judge, or waiting to go to court, because that's what we're trying to do now.
You jail can vote. Yes. If you, unless you're convicted.
Mm-hmm.
And then once you're off of probation and parole, you're told you have to pay with that same day you go and register to vote. So that's what we go around and let people know about their voting rights. And also we're trying to get on the rise. We're going to start with Columbus, Georgia, going into their jails and starting jail days for them.
Thank y'all for staying. But also, please support the work that these folks and these brilliant, beautiful folks are doing. Thank y'all so much.
Thank you.